Greetings. Today we're going to figure out how to turn votes into seats, into political office. As with the different executive legislative arrangements, there are two broad methods for doing this in democracies, and then there's a third hybrid approach. So naturally, each method has its advantages and its disadvantages, and we're going to talk about those as well. But let's start with the kind of system that we're most familiar with here in America, and that is a majoritarian electoral system. So these systems have single-member districts, and that simply means that the polity is divided into electoral districts, and that each district sends one representative after the election. This is what American students will be used to, and to the left here you can see the old Ohio electoral districts. These are single-member districts for the House of Representatives races, and each district sends one representative after the election. For the Senate election, Ohio itself essentially becomes one single-member district. We have one senator go up at a time, and that senator wins the whole state. Within a single-member district, there are basically two ways to determine who gets the seat. Plurality rules or majority rules. The difference here is the threshold. Plurality means that the largest percentage, even when that percentage is less than 50%, wins, whereas majority means over 50%. Therefore, under plurality rules, the candidate who receives the largest percentage of the vote in the district wins that district. The candidate does not actually have to win the majority, over 50%. This candidate just needs to win more than any other candidate. These systems are often called first-past-the-post rules because it resembles a horse race in which the horse that crosses the finish line first, by however slim a margin, wins the whole race. So a photo finish is still a victory. Similarly, whichever candidate wins the most votes in a first-past-the-post plurality system wins the entire district, regardless of how slim the margin is. Therefore, if you are a candidate and you win 40% of the vote, but your biggest competitor gets only 39.99% of the vote, that job is yours. This is the electoral system in the United States, the United Kingdom, Mexico, and India. The other type of majoritarian single-member district electoral system involves majority rules. Just as this name implies, these rules require that the winner get an absolute majority of the votes, that is, 50% of the votes plus one vote. Because of this requirement, these elections often require two rounds, a first round in which any qualified candidate can compete, and then a second round in which only the two largest vote-getters from the first round compete. With only two candidates allowed in the second round, the results are virtually guaranteed to include a majority, except in the very unlikely circumstances of an absolute tie, which, if you can imagine, in an election of millions and millions of voters, that's not very likely. So let's look at a couple examples. First, here is the 2008 election in the 15th District of Ohio, which included large parts of Columbus. As you can see here, the Democrat, Mary Jo Kilroy, won only 0.7% more of the vote than her Republican competitor, Steve Stivers. However, because of the first-past-the-post rules, she won the seat. Of course, in the 2010 election, Stivers beat her by enough of a margin that he could have won under majority rules. So we turn to those rules next. Under majority rules, somebody has to get a majority, which means 50% plus one. Here are the results from the 2012 presidential election in France. In the first round, all qualified candidates ran, and as you can see, nobody got too close to a majority. Thus, a second round was necessary to get that majority. In the second round, the top two vote-getters compete against one another. And as you can see, in the second round, the candidates were the incumbent president and the candidate of the center-right, Nicolas Sarkozy, pictured here on the right, and the challenging candidate from the left, François Hollande, pictured here on the left. In this election, an election between two candidates, you're virtually guaranteed to get one with a majority, and indeed we did see a majority for François Hollande with 51.64% of the vote, and that is why he is the current French president. So that's life under majoritarian electoral rules. Now, let's switch it up and look at how proportional electoral systems work. In these systems, there are also electoral districts, but there are multiple members elected from each district. Thus, one district might send 10 or 20 or 100 representatives to the legislature. In fact, some countries are just one big electoral district. The number of representatives from each party is determined proportionally. That is, each party will send about the same percentage of representatives to the legislature as the percentage of the vote it won in the election. So if you get 20% of the vote, you'll get 20% of the seats. There are two main ways of deciding which candidate in particular goes to the legislature: open list rules and closed list rules. But before getting into those in detail, let's consider a couple of things. First, do not confuse plurality with proportional. So it's very easy to confuse these two terms, and indeed students often mix them up. So let's review. Proportional means that parties are allocated seats in proportion to the percentage of votes that they received. There will be roughly the same percentage of seats for each party as the percentage of votes they won. Conversely, here, plurality means more than any other. Remember, the winner in a plurality election is the candidate with the most votes, regardless of whether that's a majority or not. Alright, so now that we have that sorted, let's consider another caveat with proportional representation systems. They often have thresholds. These are minimal percentages of votes required for a party to get any representation at all in Parliament. So 5% or less is pretty common. These are just put in place to keep too many parties from being in the legislature, and to help weed out extremist parties that tend to only attract a small percentage of the vote. Thus, if there is a minimum threshold of 5%, and your party gets 4.9% of the vote, you get no seats, and that 4.9% of the seats is divvied out to parties that won 5% of the vote. So let's take a look at an example of proportional representation in action. Here are the results from Brazil's 2010 elections for the Chamber of Deputies, which is one of that state's two legislative bodies, very similar to our House of Representatives. As you can see, Brazil has many political parties, and the percentage of the vote they received overall is very close to the percentage of seats they got in the legislature. They aren't exactly the same because of the way the vote percentages play out in the districts and the exact formulas for turning the percentage of votes into the seats, but you can still see that these two percentages are awfully close. So proportional systems give parties seats in direct proportion to the percentage of votes they get. But which specific candidates go to the Capitol? Well, that is determined primarily in one of two ways. The first is open list rules. Under open list rules, parties put together a list of candidates and they put that list on the ballot. Then people vote for one of those candidates. So people vote for candidates and they choose the candidate from the list presented by the party. Within the votes cast for each party, the candidates are ranked from the person who attracted the most votes to the person who attracted the least. Within the district as a whole, the parties are granted the number of seats in proportion to the percentage of votes they received. For example, if Party A won 30% of the vote in a district that has 10 seats, that party will get 3 seats. The top 3 vote-attracting candidates from Party A will win seats. The other candidates in Party A are out of luck. And remember, the top 3 candidates are determined by the number of votes, so the people vote for specific candidates. Another way to determine who gets seats is via the closed list rules. Again, parties present a list of candidates for the district's ballot. Unlike under the open list rules, however, here the party's ordering is the order that candidates will be granted seats. So voters come in and cast a vote for a party list, not a candidate. That's important. Voters choose a party, not a specific candidate. Thus, you'd get a ballot and every party in the election would be listed and you'd see their lists of candidates, but you don't get to choose which person specifically you want to vote for. You just select from the party list. Again, seats are allocated to the parties in proportion to the percentage of votes that they won, but the specific candidates who get seated are determined by the order they appear on the party's list, as determined by the party leadership, not the voters. Thus, if Party A wins 40% of the votes in a 10-seat district, that party gets, you guessed it, 4 seats. Those seats are allocated based upon the order of candidates determined by the party, so these systems tend to give party leadership more control and makes being loyal to the party leadership pretty important. So if I'm a rebel within a party and I anger the party leadership, That might make them put me at the 10th position in a 10-seat district, which means I'm not getting a seat outside of the unlikely event that my party wins 100% of the vote. So, over the last 10 minutes, you've become familiar with the electoral systems that dominate most of the world. Most of the world has some form of either majoritarian or proportional electoral system. So, good job. Now, the obvious question is, which is better? Is the majoritarian or the proportional system better? Well, again, there are inherent trade-offs here, and it really depends on what you value in terms of what is more democratic, as well as upon societal factors and other political institutions. So let's look at some of the broadest pros and cons of each system briefly. What's great about the majoritarian laws that we have come used to in the United States? Well, first, they favor majorities, and what that means is that you get more effective government. There doesn't need to be as much bargaining, and you can also get more stability. Because each district sends one representative, that person has a link to his or her geographic district. That means that the geographic district is that representative's constituency. So regardless of whether you voted for or against your representative, he or she is still obliged to hear your opinion or to help you if you request that help. That person is your representative. It's your district's representative to the national or federal government. What's the downside of majoritarian electoral rules? Well, one of its advantages, that it manufactures majorities, is also a disadvantage from the perspective of minority representation. If your party gets 10% of the vote, you'll get 0% of the representation. So minorities are often disadvantaged by these systems. There's also a sense in which majoritarian electoral rules, and particularly plurality rules, waste a great number of votes. Imagine an election between three parties, in which one party gets 35% of the vote, another gets 33%, and another gets 32% of the vote. Well, the winner is the party with 35% of the vote, but that means that the representative from that district will win, even though 65% of the people in her district voted against her. In a sense, that 65% of the vote is being wasted. You can see how these systems, by wasting votes and favoring bigger parties, can lead to parties being very over or underrepresented. So does the proportional electoral system fix all of these problems? Well, it does have certain advantages. First, it doesn't waste nearly as many votes. In that same election we just discussed, each of those three parties would get about the same percentage of seats as the percentage of votes they attracted. So that 65% of votes would not have been wasted. This intuitively seems to be a fair distribution, as parties are not favored over one another. Finally, this proportionality encourages minority representation and a greater representation of diverse viewpoints outside of those of the big parties. What about the downsides? Well, first, because of the multi-member districts, these citizens don't really have their own representative. The districts often have many representatives, maybe over 20. So if you live in a 20-member district, who do you write your letter with your opinion or request to? The sense of constituency services in single-member districts is simply absent, though you might be able to contact parties based on ideological or partisan grounds. Also, the proportionality of these systems can lead to many, many parties getting representation, as you saw in the case of Brazil. Again, this strength in terms of diversity and minority representation also turns out to be a weakness, as when there are a bunch of parties, it can be more difficult to govern effectively. More parties means more instability, more debate over every little issue, and more trouble making and maintaining coalitions. So in these electoral systems, we've seen some of our old trade-offs in democracy. The tension between representing many viewpoints and being fair, and getting to the business of governing. It's hard to say one system is really better than the other objectively, because they provide very different sorts of goods with different disadvantages. Some countries, including Germany, Japan, and Hungary, have tried a middle route and used mixed electoral systems. These countries basically have both single-member districts elected by majoritarian rules, as well as multi-member districts in which seats are allocated proportionally. This can be rather complicated, but it's an attempt to combine the benefits of majoritarian elections with greater stability and constituency services with the advantages of proportional representations, fairer representation of diverse perspectives. Let's look at Germany's 2009 federal elections. Basically, if you're a German citizen, you get to go to the polls and you cast two votes for the federal legislature. First, you vote for your district's representative in the election of the single-member district. Then, you vote for a party list for the multi-member district. The German system is very unique because they guarantee that the winner of every single member district's majoritarian election gets a seat and then use the national percentages of the vote to allocate seats based on the party list, so that parties get an overall proportion equal to that cast in the proportional election. So this is complicated, and it means that the number of seats in the German legislature can actually shift from election to election. I know, it's confusing. For our purposes, it's only important to remember that these systems exist. It's also important to remember that there is another tension, that between being perfectly fair and being straightforward enough that voters can understand what they are doing with their votes. We have only gone over the most common and most basic electoral systems. As you can see with the German system, things can get kind of complicated, and this system is downright simple compared to some other systems like the single non-transferable vote system, which I don't even want to go into. In the name of being perfectly fair, some complicated and downright bizarre institutions can be put in place, and at a certain point, the complexity of the system starts to work against the fairness. Okay, so we've gone over a lot of kind of technical stuff today. So before I leave you, I want to make sure that we're on the same page and that we get what's up here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to present you with some vote percentages, and I'm going to ask you to write down what the seats would look like in the parliament. And I think that would be really helpful if you actually do write it down, because you are going to face very similar questions on the tests. So it's a good opportunity now to give it a try, see where your questions are in case you need to bring them up early. So go get a pen and paper or open up a Word document. I'll wait. You can pause me. I don't mind. Are you ready? All right. So here is your first situation. Here are the election results. You can see there's five parties, and here are the percentage of each party's votes. Now, here are the questions. What would the results be under plurality first past the post rules, and what would the results be under proportional representation? So I'm going to go ahead and let you write that answer down before we move on. Alright, have you got it? Well, let's look at plurality rules. Remember, under plurality rules, the winner is whoever gets the largest percentage of votes. So the most votes wins, no matter whether that's over a majority or not. So here, the Conservative Party would win with just a margin of 0.1% of the vote. That means that they get 100% of that one seat. So this would be in a single member district, obviously. Now let's look at proportional representation, or PR. Under proportional representation, the percentage of seats is roughly equal to the percentage of votes, and what that means is that the percentage of votes here would be roughly the same as the percentage of seats. So you can see it would really depend on the specific rules, but suffice to say that it looked pretty much the same in the legislature as it did at the election results. It doesn't really manufacture majority, and that means that effectively the Social Democrats and Conservatives would probably tie once you actually divided up the votes. Alright, one more and then you're done. Here is Country B's election result. Again, you can see we have five parties and there are these percentages of votes. And the questions are, who would win under a majority rule? And who wins under proportional rules, or not who wins, rather, what do the votes look like under proportional rules with a 5% minimum threshold? Again, write down your answer. All right, are you ready? Under majority rules, there would be no winner, because remember, a majority means that you need to have over 50% of the vote to be a winner. That means this would be kind of like a first round election, and there would need to be a second round. And in the second round, the top two vote earners, that is the Equality Movement with 39% of the vote and the Classic Liberals with 37% of the vote, would face off in an election. What about under the proportional representation with a 5% threshold? Well, in this system, again, votes would be allocated proportionally, so the parties earn about the same percentage of seats as votes, but because of that 5% minimum threshold, the scary nationalists get no seats. They got 4%, they didn't pass the threshold, So that means they get zero seats. They have nothing in the legislature. Their seats get redistributed to the other parties. So all the other parties get a bit of a bump. So that's why you see that they'd all get the percentage of the vote they got, or maybe a little more. All right. Well, that was a lot today. Congratulations on getting through it. Please contact me with any questions you have, because there was a lot of complicated material. And good luck.